Good morning, Providence.
Good morning.
Esteemed guests and honored visitors. Puritan theologian Thomas Case wrote, "We are great strangers to the cross. Sufferings have obtained an ill name in the world, but God teaches his people in afflictions. He teaches us to feel compassion toward others who are suffering. I think perhaps many of us thank God that we don't suffer like that person. Or we despise the suffering that God does allow. So this morning, as we meet to worship on this theme, I give you 2 points to ponder. One, earthly suffering is one thing. Eternal suffering is quite another. Secondly, do we pray like Jesus prayed? Not my will, but yours be done. So let us remember that the cross is not a tool of Satan, but is an instrument by which God saves the world. Will you take up your cross and follow him? Let us stand together and worship the man called Jesus. Hymn number 592, Jesus Calls Us.
Pray with us. Father, today we do know that you call us, Jesus calls us of certainly o'er the tumult of life's wild, restless sea. Lord, all the things that come to us, all the things that we endure, all the things that we suffer in this life are going to be nothing, the old apostle says, compared to the glory that we shall know in your presence as your children. So you, in the midst of this earthly suffering, in the midst of the earthly tumult, you call us to be your disciples, to be your emissaries in the world, to speak your message so that all might hear and all might know, and as many as will might respond, so they too might know the bliss and the joy of eternal life with you. Father, we just come to you in these moments with so many issues. We come to you with such heavy heart this morning with so many of life's burdens and tumults. And we just pray for relief in your presence. Father, your son Jesus told us when he was about to leave us from this earthly life, "My peace I leave with you, my peace I give unto you, not as the world gives, but I give you a peace that will last eternally." Father, we seek to live in the midst of that peace today that passes all understanding. Certainly in the tumults of life, in the storms of life, and the disappointments of life, Father, we come to you and plead for that peace. That peace where there is no end, and the ultimate of it is joy eternally in your presence. Father, in these moments we pray for the power of your Spirit. for the joy of worshiping in your presence. For Holy Father, you are like that dear friend whom we love to see coming down the road. It just gives us a leap of joy in our heart. Father, you give us that leap of joy this morning in your presence. Spirit of God, fall fresh on us in this hour and speak to our hearts, salve our wounds, convict us of our lostness and our need for you, and bring us safely home. In Jesus' name, amen.
Let us stand and sing our fellowship chorus. You know, sometimes being a blessing is a cross too. We don't always feel like being a blessing to others. But let us sing that. Take up your cross and make me a blessing. Another this morning. You may be seated. Thank you. The choir is going to start us off this morning, and then I'll have you join in on a song I'm sure you know. us really know what a treasure we have in Jesus Christ? Do we truly know that He is like just rooms, more than rooms full of gold, the world full of gold and diamonds? Nothing compares to Him. And I know we get so bogged down in our earthly life, in the cares of this world. And that's why He kept saying, don't worry about the things of this world. Look to Me. Take up your cross and follow Me. That's where the treasure is. Won't you sing with us now in this chorus?
And the work that we seek to do here in this community. Lord, there are just so
many things that you are busy doing in our lives. Help us, Father, to pause, stop, reflect, and thank you for the work that you're doing amidst us, among us. Lord, sometimes, even though we don't realize it, you're working in us and through us. So help us to pause and to be grateful, to be consistent, to be busy about the work that you give us to do. And Father, we just pray that our reward might be others that we might bring to you, who will, as well as us, spend eternal bliss in your presence on earth that's being prepared for us for eternity. Lord, we just ask you to capture us up in this moment. Help us to lay back against your breast as your weary children. Father, today we pray for our missionaries who we support that are across this globe. We pray for Brother Joe and Brother Demas and others who are our local missionaries that we support. We pray for our North American missionaries who carry the message of the gospel of salvation. We pray for those missionaries who carry your word to the far-flung corners of the earth, especially those today, Lord, that bring your message in the midst of people who hate them so badly that their real names cannot even be known. Their true identities cannot be made known to us because the danger is so great. Lord, we live in a world that hates the name of Christ, the very name that loves us and gave himself for us. For that, we're sorry. But we ask you to help us to be faithful as your disciples, to continue to lift your name up that others might know you. Know the sweetness and fullness of your Spirit. Father, I just pray for our young men and women who serve this country, for their safety as they face the hardships and the battles of warfare, for their families whom they leave behind. Father, I pray for them. I pray for our children and our children's homes. You've given us the responsibility of nurturing and caring for them. Lord, I pray for our young children, our parents, young parents and parents with children. Lord, I just ask you to help them to see the need for raising that child in the nurture and admonition of the Lord so that when they're older, they won't depart from it. Thank you for our Awana group who will come tonight and share with us. For those children who are learning your word, who are learning how to apply it to their lives, Lord, we pray your blessings upon them. And ask you, Father, to just anoint them with your Spirit, and that that promise might be made good to us, that when they're old, they will not depart from it. Lord, we just continue to pray for this hour. We lift Brother Joe up. We ask you to anoint him with your Spirit. We ask, O Father, that your Spirit would be rich and real in this place, that it would speak to our hearts the words we need to hear, the message we need to have, that it would meet, he would meet the needs that we have in accordance with your will. Father, we pray all of this and we lift it up to you in Jesus' name.
Miss Shirley is on the rise back there. That means she's headed out with children's worship.
Let God's people stand and let us sing hymn number 161. That's not correct. 552. That would be better. A much better hymn. Let us sing.
I am thine, O Lord, I have heard thy voice, and return. thank you, Lord, for this time and place that we can come this morning to worship you in spirit and truth. And Lord, as we give back now these tithes and offerings, we pray that they might be used to glorify the name of Jesus here on earth. We pray it all in his name. Amen.
Amen.
Take up your cross and follow Jesus. Just take up your cross every day. Now don't be ashamed to say that you know him. Just count the cost, then take up your cross and follow him. I'm gonna ask you something now. What are you doing for the King? Now have you really given your everything for the one who gave his all for you? Now don't you be satisfied just to know that the Lord has saved your soul. Now have you forgotten what you need to do? Take up your cross
and follow Jesus.
Just take up your cross. Take it up every day. Now don't be ashamed to say that you know it. Just
thank you, Sean, and musicians. We appreciate all you do to bring us to worship and lead us in worship in the ways that you do. We appreciate that so much. It's a privilege to be able to be with you as your associational missionary today. It's always a privilege, whatever capacity I come in, but to have the invitation to come as your associational missionary here at the beginning of the prayer for missions, and particularly for associational missions, is truly a pleasure and a privilege. I don't want to spend a lot of time talking about the association or associational missions today, actually. We do have the 37 now churches and church plants or other churches that are under the watch care of your association. We also have a work that's begun with the Filipino community in Jacksonville, and they are meeting every week now in the gymnasium at the association. And we have a group from Raleigh that's coming in to help us to reach out to the Vietnamese across our community as well. The later two works, the Filipino and the Vietnamese work, are relatively new. We're just getting started with those, and they are not under the watch care of the association yet, but we hope that they'll continue to grow and to formalize, materialize a little bit, and then ask to come under the watch care of our association. And we would invite you to pray for those works and for our church plants. We have Ingolf Church that's working with regular services in Jacksonville, and they have regular services at the USO. The Watermark Church, which is in the Swansboro area, a church plant that began a little over a year ago. On Easter Sunday, they had about 300 in attendance there. And then we have the Pillar Church, which is focusing a lot on the military community, 40 to 50 folks in worship every Sunday at the Baptist Center as well. And recently, the Catherine Lake Church, which was a part of the association, left a few years ago, has asked to come back into the association. And so we're excited about the work that's going on across our association that you support by the many gifts and talents that you support, that you give, that you offer to our association. There are those things that through the years we have tried to do as regular annual or semi-annual kinds of training events, opportunities that would help you to be able to be better leaders, to grow as better disciples, and those things kind of continue. However, when I joined the staff about 8 years ago or so, we had five ministerial staff. Today, there are less than two of us on the ministerial staff. So the opportunities for us to be able to do the kinds of things at the level that we used to do them are just not there. We're trying to continue to do all the things that we used to do with fewer people. And the only way we can do that is to rely on you as the volunteers across our association to help us with those things. When we reorganized, we established ministry action teams, and those teams that are made up of volunteers from across the association are the way we're trying to do our ministry mostly today. So we invite you to continue to pray for us. We, in fact, implore you to do that, to pray for us. The gifts that you give continue to help us do the things that need to be done as we try to resource our existing churches to be able to be strengthened, to do more of what you're doing, and also to help bring in new works. We are told that we're able to, in fact, the statistics will play out, will show the validity to this, that we are able to reach more people who are lost for Christ through new work than we are through existing work. So some folks say, well, we don't need any more churches. We have enough churches. Well, yeah, we have enough churches if everybody were coming to church and if everybody were able to reach everybody within their community. But even that wouldn't be enough, because if we filled this church three times on Sunday, along with every other church in our association, we still would not reach all the people. We would not have enough room to seat everybody. So we need new churches to be able to keep up with the way our communities across our Onslow area and beyond is growing. And so we implore you to continue to pray for us and help us. What I want to focus on today, though, is a message I'm trying to get across our association that deals with discipleship. Because the truth of the matter is, if we were all doing all that we possibly could as disciples, if we were all as faithful as the Lord has called us to be as disciples, regardless of our age or our circumstances in life, then we would see this church and all of our churches filled, and we would have to add services, and we would have new churches as well. So it really comes back to the commitment of those of us who've accepted Christ, or for those who today may not know.
Jesus, these words, mostly of yours that we've read today, your teaching to us are hard words. And we pray for the presence and the leadership of your Holy Spirit to hear what it is you have to say, not just the words of this messenger, but your Holy Spirit to speak to us today. And we ask it in Christ's name and for his sake, for the sake of your kingdom, dear Lord Jesus. How many of you have ever done any wilderness camping? Maybe you've gone to a campsite somewhere out there, or you've pitched a tent somewhere. Anybody into the wilderness or an adventurous thing? Just raise your hand. Let me say I have a few people, okay, that know what I'm talking about here. Well, it's interesting, when some people go to the wilderness, what their idea about an adventure really is. This citation comes from Mike Niefert in a book called Light and Life. Talked about actual responses from comment cards that were given to staff members at the Bridger Wilderness Area, that's in Wyoming. Now remember, this is a wilderness area that people sign up for, make reservations for. They go there because it is what? A wilderness area. Now these are some of the comments that were received. Trails need to be reconstructed. Please avoid building trails that go uphill. Too many bugs and leeches and spiders and spider webs. Please spray the wilderness to rid the areas of these pests. Please pave the trails. Chairlifts need to be in some places so that we can get to the wonderful views without having to hike to them. The coyotes made too much noise last night and kept me awake. Please eradicate these annoying animals. A small deer came into my camp and stole my jar of pickles. Is there any way I can get reimbursed? Escalators would help on steep hill sections. A McDonald's would be nice at the trailhead. How about this one? Too many rocks in the mountains. I mean, come on. get real, if you would please. And yet, it's interesting that those kinds of comments we would not expect to hear from people who sign up for a wilderness experience. And yet, there are those of us who sign up to be Christians, to follow Jesus, who died on the cross to show us what it means to live for God and to live like we love Him. And yet, we expect everything to be as if we were going to the local, I'm afraid to use any one hotel more than another to advertise for somebody, but a local hotel, and have all of the greatest pleasures that we possibly can. David Platt, I think, understands this. He wrote a book called Radical. Perhaps you've read it. David Platt was the youngest megachurch pastor in history when he went to the Brook Hills Church in Birmingham, Alabama. He is now the youngest president of the International Mission Board of our Southern Baptist Convention. At age 36 last year, he came to be the president of the IMB. He said this, "I am convinced that we as Christ followers in American churches have embraced values and ideas that are not only unbiblical, but that are actually contradict the gospel we claim to believe. And I am convinced we have a choice. You and I can choose to continue with business as usual in the Christian life and in the church as a whole, enjoying success based on the standards defined by the culture around us. Or we can take an honest look at the Jesus of the Bible and dare to ask what the consequences might be if we really believed Him and really obeyed Him." So I want us to think together for a few minutes this morning about radical discipleship. Radical discipleship. What John Piper calls real discipleship. Piper says there are three kinds of people in the world. There are non-disciples. They don't believe in Jesus at all. Then there are unreal disciples. And then there are real disciples. The real disciples are what I want us to think about as being radical disciples. When we think of this word radical, your pastor helped me understand several months ago when we were doing some planning for one of our associational meetings about that word radical. You know, the root part of radical is the rad, right? And rad comes from the word that means what? Root. We eat radishes because they are what? They are roots. Okay? And so the rad, or the root, the foundation, that part which is most basic, is a part of what we talk about as being radical. But then also we think about radical when we think about something that's outlandish, something that is unconventional, unorthodox, thinking outside the box. And in essence, a Christian disciple has to have both. We have to have our roots deep in Jesus, in the foundation, in God's word, that we know where our root is and what our roots are, and that's where we are rooted. But we also have to be willing to think outside the box, to be unconventional. How are we going to reach the people around us if we always stay the same old way? If we don't think of what is exciting out there, what is new, what are the possibilities that we could bring into our church so that we can reach those people who maybe think a little bit differently than the way we think? Not changing who we are in our foundation, but maybe being willing to look a little bit different. And I'm beginning to think, as a member of this church and realizing you've called a new pastor, that things might be just a little different. I hope not too radical, yes, but might be just a little bit different. And if they are, we're going to have to be willing as a church to hear what it is that God might be saying through the new leader that you have called, that we have called to be the pastor here. And we're going to have to be open to some of those things that might be a little more unconventional, a little unorthodox, perhaps, in the way that we've been thinking. We're going to need to be prepared for how God will lead us to be able to reach the world around us. And that might mean we have to be a little more radical. Jesus has some radical things to say in this passage, and if I gave you even all the notes that I have on these two pages, I probably would keep us much longer than you would want to stay here. But let me see if I can give you some of the highlights of what I have here.
this context of the passage that we have for us here. If you go back to verse 33 in chapter 13, verse 33 in chapter 13, just back probably one page. Jesus says, "Nevertheless, I must go on my way today and tomorrow and the day following, for it cannot be that a prophet should perish away from Jerusalem." Jesus is on his way to Jerusalem. He knows that he's going to be crucified there. And with this in mind, and now as he's been in his ministry for 2 years plus and moving toward the cross, he knows he's got to bring some things down to the real foundation. He's got to get serious with his disciples and with all of those who would be his disciples. And dear friends, I think as we are counting down the clock for Jesus to come back, he wants us to be serious in this world about what it is he's called us to be and to be able to reach a lost and dying world on its way to hell all around us today. And the context is we all need to be moving toward Jerusalem. We all need to be moving toward the coming of the Lord, the time when we might come face to face with the sacrifices that we're going to have to make. And I believe before he comes, the church is going to have to make more sacrifices. I believe he's calling us to greater sacrifice. And as we move toward it, we need to be prepared for it. And the only way to be prepared for it is to be the disciples that he's called us to be. Jesus tells us, or rather we are told before Jesus speaks here in verse 25, that there are great crowds who are accompanying him. Great crowds accompanying. Why are they accompanying him? He's been feeding them. He's been doing miracles in their midst. He's been healing them. He's been showing them the very presence and power of God in their midst. There are some of those who begin to think he's the Messiah from the standpoint of their national perspective, that he's going to establish Israel once again, and it's going to look like it did under King David so many generations before. And they're looking to him to do that. And the critical mass is beginning to swell as the people see Jesus and he's becoming more and more popular amongst the people, even though the religious leaders are beginning to feel threatened more and more by him. And Jesus knows that there's going to be this clash and ultimately he's going to be crucified. But he looks at all of these crowds and he looks at what is their motivation. And he realizes that so many are following him for the wrong motivation. And so we are told, he turns and says to them, he looks and sees a motivation that's not where it needs to be and says, "I need to get these people focused on what the real motivation needs to be." And so he says, "Anyone, if anyone comes to me," that's you and me. He's speaking to us today and to the millions and the billions throughout history who've come to know Jesus. And he's speaking to everyone who might be here today and has never accepted him as Savior, who's never committed to him as your Lord. He's speaking to you and to all of the rest of us. If anyone would come to me, or does come to me. And so we are included in that. He's speaking to us. And he says, if anyone comes to me and does not hate, and then he goes on and lists all of those people who might be closest to us, the people that we might love the most, the people to whom we might have the greatest commitment, the people with whom we might spend the greatest amount of our time and our emotion and all of who we are. He says, if we would come to him, we must be willing to hate those individuals. Now, there are some preachers and some commentators, if you read the commentaries, who would say, well, this hate is in kind of, just a level of love. Jesus was all about love, and so this word hate is just kind of a lower level of love. Well, I would tell you that this Greek term, miseo, which is translated here hate, is the same one that is used by Jesus in terms of the Greek language here in Matthew 10:22, when Jesus says to his disciples, "You will be hated for my name's sake." He's saying the same way the disciples will be hated is the way that we need to hate those that we love the most. If we're going to be his disciple. And in fact, he says, unless we do that, we cannot be his disciple. That's a pretty harsh teaching, yes? But that's what Jesus says to us today. It's much more harsh here than in a passage that sounds like it in Matthew 10:37, when he says, he who loves father, mother, son, or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. There he does turn it around a little bit. It's softer, isn't it? That if we love them more than we love him, then we're not worthy of him. But here he says, unless we're willing to hate them, then we cannot be his disciple. This is a harsh teaching. And I think he's trying to help us, as he tried to help those disciples, understand what it means that we are to follow him. And it doesn't just stop at our family members or those that are closest to us. He says, or even your own life also, in verse 26 there. Not only do we have to be willing to hate those, but willing to hate our own life as well, if we're going to be his disciple. But we have a choice, don't we? We have a choice we can make. It's not like, well, I'm going to become a Christian, and in this religion, I have to do this, or they're going to chop my head off, or chop my hand off. Okay? He gives us a choice. And that's why we are where we are in our following him today. Some of you are way up there already, being willing to accept this level of discipleship. Some of us are not at that level of discipleship yet. But he gives us a choice, and he loves us to grow us into that. Because you see, Jesus is always love. And he's always teaching us in the context of love. So Jesus, even though he says here we have to be willing to hate even our own lives and those others, he also teaches us that we need to love God above all else. And we need to love our neighbor as we love ourselves. The Apostle Paul teaches us out of the context of Jesus' love that we need to speak the truth, but do it how? In love. We know throughout the scriptures, regardless of whatever picture is painted of God or of Jesus, that it's all in the context of love. So this is not hate speech. This is not what those outside the church are going to say, well, this is hate speech, and you just bring hate speech from the pulpit, and that Jesus is all about hating. Just here, look at this passage, what it says. No, that's not it. Jesus is love. God is love. God's word is filled with love. It's because of his love for you and for me that he died on the cross. And it's the love that we have for those who are dying and going to hell around us that motivates us. But Jesus is trying to call us to a level of discipleship that most of us may not understand. A radical disciple. But we do have a choice. I want to tell you about Heather Mercer and Dana Curry. They were arrested by the Taliban and held prisoner for 128 days in Afghanistan. This goes all the way back to 2001. These two young ladies both attended Baylor University. They surrendered their lives to be fully devoted followers of Jesus. Dateline interviewed Heather Mercer's mother. And it was the kind of story that the journalist really liked, because they had discovered that Heather's mother was totally opposed to Heather making the decision to go to work for Christ in Afghanistan. They really tried to play up the story to show how Heather's commitment to Christ had divided her family. They wanted to keep asking her how she could do something her mother opposed. But she had a choice. And she made the choice to follow Christ. Not necessarily literally to hate her mother, but to be willing to say that what God is calling me to do, where Christ is leading me, is more important than what my mother thinks about that. And I must be obedient to Christ. In her book, Prisoners of Hope, she wrote, "We answered hard questions posed by our families and friends. Extraordinary are the parents who don't balk at the idea of their child moving to a third world, war-ravaged, drought-stricken country. And in this case, a country serving as a hub for international terrorist activity. That we had decided to go as Christian aid workers to a country where a harsh, unpredictable regime, severely curtailed religious freedom, gave most of our loved ones pause at best, and otherwise prompted serious alarm. We were asked, aren't you being foolish? Why would you jeopardize your own safety? And she said in an interview in 2011, there is no other reason to be in a place like Afghanistan if you cannot offer the only source of hope to people who have no hope. Her motivation was as Christ led her to take hope to a dying people without Jesus and to offer Christ to them. We know the Apostle Paul tells us in Galatians 6:14, may I never boast except in that of our Lord Jesus Christ. Those which the world has been crucified to me and I to the world. If we're going to follow Christ, as he tells us here, we must be willing to bear our cross, to take up our cross and to follow him, to be crucified to the world, but to be raised in life of love and service to Christ. And that takes Christian discipline. And I think that's where we begin to break down, because to be a disciple, we have to be disciplined. It's not just a matter of accepting Christ, walking this aisle, being baptized in the water, and now we're instant disciples to the level that God or Christ would want us to be. There was a Russian comedian named Yakov Smirnov. When he came to the United States, he tells that he went to a supermarket, and he went down one of the aisles, and he saw something called powdered milk. Just add water, and you get milk. And he went down another aisle, and there was a product called orange juice powder, or powdered orange juice. Just add water, and you get orange juice. And then he went down another aisle, and he saw something called baby powder. And he said, well, isn't America great? All you do is add water and you get babies. You know. Sometimes we feel like all we have to do is get dunked in the water of the baptismal and we are an instant disciple at the level where we need to be. Nobody gets there instantly. Nobody's able to be an Olympic anything, swimmer, athlete of any kind, without practicing the disciplines. So too as Christians. We're not able to get where we need to be in our discipleship unless we're willing to practice the disciplines. So we look at God's word and the need to pray, the need to study, the need to fellowship, the need to worship, the need to commit ourselves to service to him. Every day spending time with him, with one another, and with the word. In prayer and meditation and Bible study and fellowship and in service as we go out in his name to offer the cup of cold water, to visit the sick, to visit the imprisoned, to minister to those in grief, to love those around us who have various needs that oftentimes we just overlook, and to share the good news, the love of Jesus Christ. Sometimes that means we have to hate ourselves enough to give up all the comforts that we normally experience and that we desire to be able to do what he's calling us to do. And that takes discipline. Every day, Jesus says, take up your cross daily and follow me. Every day, to crucify ourselves and to commit ourselves to him. And it is a matter of commitment. Larry Sarver, the pastor of Calvary Chapel in Palm City, Florida, said the question we need to ask ourselves is not, am I able to follow Jesus completely, but am I willing to follow Jesus completely? Dear friends, none of us is able to follow Jesus completely. We're not able to do that. But if we're willing to, the Holy Spirit gives us the ability to do whatever it is the Lord has called us to do. We can't hate those around us in our own power, in our own spirit, because we love them. We care for them. And I look at some of these preachers now in some pretty highfalutin places that when a family member, in one case of a Southern Baptist pastor, his son came out of the closet and identified as homosexual, the pastor then changed what he had been preaching for decades. Why? I understand that. Because of his love for his son. But Jesus said, if you're not willing to hate your son, you cannot be my disciple. Now, you're not going to hate your son, but you're certainly going to have to draw some lines and make a decision. Am I going to be his disciple, or am I going to do what's comfortable for me? And Jesus said, you cannot be my disciple if you're not willing to do what I've called you to do. Jesus finishes up this passage with giving some examples that we wouldn't begin to build a building unless we knew we could finish it. We wouldn't have a king who would commit to go out to war unless he knew that there was a pretty good chance he was going to win it. Otherwise, he would send an emissary and make peace. There is an application here when we need to be most concerned about making peace with King Jesus. We're at this point in our life, he's calling us to accept him as our Savior and commit ourselves to him as our Lord, to be his disciple. But he wants us to count the cost. But we need to understand, if we're not willing to pay the cost, that we won't spend eternity with him. We cannot be his disciple. He really is not our Savior. So we have to be willing to count the costs. And if it looks like there's going to be some pretty high costs involved, then we need to go forward to him and make peace with him. Commit ourselves to him. Ask him to be our Savior and Lord. And pray the Holy Spirit will help us to discipline ourselves to be all that he needs us to be. I implore you today, if you don't know him, accept him. It's hard, but it's worth it, because the reward is eternity and the very presence of the Lord Jesus Christ himself. If you've made that commitment to him, then I would ask you to count the cost. And today, perhaps there's a need for a recommitment or to a new level of commitment, that we might be what he needs us to be in our world today. Brother Preston's going to be at the front. We're going to sing a hymn of invitation. If the Lord leads you to make a decision, the altar is open. You can come and pray. You can do what the Lord leads you to do, to share your testimony, offer yourself to him. Come and speak with Preston. If you need to speak with me, I'll be here as well. But would you accept the Lord's invitation to you today? Bow with me for just a moment. Our Father, now we pray that this invitation would be your invitation, that it would be what you need it to be, that it would speak to the life of each and every person here in the way that you want it to speak. And may we be faithful to respond in the way that you would want us to, for our sake, in relationship with you, and for the sake of your kingdom's work. In Jesus' name, amen.
Let us stand. Hymn number 598. Are you willing to go?
Joe, for being with us this morning and bringing us that wonderful message of the cost of discipleship. Don't forget our services tonight, our WANA awards at 6 o'clock. Please come and support our children as they receive those awards and as they share with you what they've been learning this year in WANA.